you very much. It's great to be here. So you may have noticed that you've been shortchanged because the program said we'll be talking about existential risks,
and said we'll be talking about
global catastrophic risks. And you can maybe ask me in the Q&A whether I think that's an important distinction or not. But I will be talking about the severe end of global catastrophic risks. So these are the kind of things that we can all agree on are pretty bad, like 10% of the population dying or worse. And what I will present here is work that was done at the Center for the Study of Existential Risk, together with Bonnie Winter, Julius Weitzdorfer, John O'Hagerty, Bill Sutherland, and Martin Riss, which is a new way of classifying existential risks. And I will try to motivate a little bit why we need this way. We are by no means claiming that this is the only way to classify existential risks, but I think it adds something useful to the way we think about some of these risks. So let's start with traditional methods of thinking about global catastrophic risks and existential risks. I hope it will be okay if I just say GCRs for now. So we have this image of the pale blue dot. This is Earth. It's taken by the Voyager probe. And it's tiny, and it's fragile, and it's where all sentient life is currently at. And it would be really, really sad if it all goes away. Even a major chunk of it goes away. And so this gets us into a point where we're thinking about, well, what could make of all of the life, the chunk that life and sentience in the body go away. And we could come up with a list of threats like this, which is from the Global Challenges Foundation report that was published in 2015, where we have this 12 potential global catastrophes. Some of these would be more familiar to you, so maybe asteroid strike or super volcanic eruption. Some of this might be less familiar to you, though maybe not in this community. And this is good. Like, we need this kind of work. We need to bring up these scenarios and think about how they might play out and what kind of work we can do to mitigate them or prevent them, probably prevent them because in any of them there's no mitigation. But there are limitations to this approach. One limitation is, you know, how certain can you be that you have covered the field? And so where do these scenarios come from? Well, they come from sci-fi, they come from sampling academic communities in a fairly stochastic manner. They come from sitting in your armchair and thinking really hard, and which are all good methods, and we should do more of them. But that doesn't give us high guarantee that we got all risks. So particularly, it might be not very good for finding out unknown unknowns, black swans, and the like, which we may suspect feature quite highly in things that we want to work on and worry about. Another one is that if you start from particular scenarios, and fairly siloed scenarios, you're not reaching out to the academic community as a whole. You're working, reaching out to the people who are in astronomy, reaching out to the people who are on pandemic prevention. While there might be a lot of relevant academic intellectual information for working on these problems elsewhere in academia. So we put together a slightly different classification method that attempts to look at the same problem. And now the analogy that drives this kind of thinking is the notion of monitoring spaceship Earth. So as you may recognize, this is the bridge of the Starship Enterprise, and you have various dashboards that monitor science, life support, and engineering, and so on. And this is somewhat borrowed from an analogy used by Jan Tallinn to great effect, which he uses when he gets you to think about AI risk, and he says, think of the future as this great spaceship that we're building in our backyard. This spaceship is going to go into the future. We've put really big engines on it, which is our AI technology. We're going to load our children onto this spaceship first. But maybe we haven't done enough work on thinking about the steering of that spaceship. Now, this is not just an analogy, right? We exist on this planet. It is a spaceship of sorts. It takes a very boring route around the sun, but a very exciting journey, millions of years into the future. We arrived on it, we didn't design it. We don't quite know how all of the life support systems and the critical systems work, but we want the journey to be safe for many years to come. And so another way to think about existential risk is trying to build up these dashboards that will help us monitor and uncover global catastrophic risks and existential risks. By the way, I think it's important to notice this doesn't exist. Right? I mean, no one knows, no one has a dashboard for the way Earth operates. Like, there's no intelligence agency or government out there that has a full knowledge also the academic view of the world and what everyone is doing and what's going to happen. Right? So we can only approximate it. But even trying to approximate it might be really useful for mitigating some of those things. So we start with some conceptual analysis, and we say for, say, a billion people to die, some critical system that is essential for keeping them alive needs to be breached. And by system here, it's anything like process, material availability, interacting factors, some way of analyzing a part of the world. Most of them operate within certain bounds, which are bounds of safe operation. And if you push the system outside of those bounds, some unpredictable and possibly quite bad things happen to it. So mapping these out is going to be one factor in thinking about risks. The second one is global threat mechanism. Right? If you want to have a global catastrophe, it needs to go global somehow. And so finding out all the ways in which causal effects become global is part of this investigation. And finally, if some catastrophe is happening or is about to happen, we probably care about it and we're probably would want to stop it. If we haven't stopped it and the catastrophe took place, it's because we failed somehow. And mapping out all of the ways we fail or we could fail is also very useful and also something that is under study in academia, and we want to return to those things. So these are the three dimensions of the classification system. We're going to look at the first two of these for now.
So along the horizontal axis, I've mapped out the critical systems.
I'm not going to go over every single one, because it's going to take a while, and also because this is still a work in progress, and as I will argue, this is dynamic. This will need to change over time.
But we went in a semi-logical fashion, going from physical systems like stability of space-time, temperature ranges, radiation levels, biogeochemical systems like the work that has been done on planetary boundaries, which I recommended you look up, through cellular, anatomical, whole organism systems, all the way up to ecological and socio-technological systems. On the vertical axis, I've mapped out some of the global spread mechanisms, and here we identify three major categories. One category is natural ways in which things could become global. So if you have an astronomical impact or that's the size of Earth, then you could take out a big portion of humans or all humans. By the way, these changes, say, if humanity goes to more than one planet. So this is another reason this needs to be dynamically updated. Anthropogenic networks, so we're a highly connected species. We move stuff and ideas and electrons around the planet. And we move ourselves around the planet, and these are ways that threats could spread as well. And finally, coupled to both of these global systems, we have replicator dynamics that also play an important role in the way things spread. So let's give some examples to flesh out how this might work. Think about nuclear winter, right? And in the same way you think about nuclear winter, also think about asteroid strike, and also think about supervolcanic eruption. Because what really matters for human survival in those three situations is that you put up a whole lot of particles into the atmosphere that block incoming sunlight. And it is the atmospheric system, which is the global conveyor for this kind of risk, that means that globally we're going to have reduction in inbound radiation and reduction in temperatures. So this is going to be a natural effect on the physical, between the physical and biogeochemical area. But of course, the downstream effects of those are going to be droughts, starvation, food system collapses, collapses of various industries that rely on agriculture and biological inputs. And those are going to take place in the ecological and socio-technological. So you can see things that are heating very basic critical systems, cascading all the way up to socio-technological systems and manifesting the damage in that way. We're also seeing a big impact in sort of anthropogenic networks and the more complex biological areas. And you can think about natural and engineered pandemics as meeting that domain. We can think about viruses that hit various cellular systems and spread through transit systems, air veins, or utility systems, the water supply. Or we can think about engineered pandemics and how they might spread through other vectors. And finally, I think it's important to highlight the highly interconnected nature of our industries. So we have wires that go everywhere, we have not many more of them with the Internet of Things, and that means that various cyber agents could have global effect, global reach. And also ideas, right? So a pernicious idea, whether it's the design of a new technology that is harmful, maybe some DIY bio, could also go around the world through these systems. So understanding how the systems work is also, I guess, that should be closer to the social technology. So these are two dimensions, and I think there is a lot more work to be done on extending and populating these. But there is also the third dimension of prevention and mitigation. So if the first two draw mostly on scientific, academic work, and technological engineering work, and maybe some mathematical modeling of complex systems, the third dimension draws a lot more on research in the humanities and social sciences. So again, this is work in progress, but we can map out ways that individuals could fail to deal with emerging risks, well, through cognitive biases, misaligned values, etc. Interpersonal, so people don't trust each other, don't communicate well, and they could be in the key position to mitigate the risk. Institutions, so we have various institutions to target some of these things. You can think about the World Health Organization, you can think about academic institutions that have been charged with dealing with existential risk. If they don't discharge the role effectively, we could end up in a very nasty situation. And finally, we could go beyond institutional, which is to ask, does the global community set up the right institutions required to meet some of these challenges? And we can also see lots of failures in that domain, because of lack of planning, because of mismatched incentives, etc. So what do we do with all of this? I'm making a little bit of what we do at CISO when we're thinking about existential risk in this sort of holistic, non-siloed way. And maybe I'll suggest some ways you could help as well. One thing we do is horizon scanning. Right, as I said, this list is dynamic. Our science improves all the time, and it's going to accelerate, and so we're going to get much better understanding of some of these systems and where the boundaries are. And also, technology will be poised to change some of those domains. Like, we keep building more of these anthropogenic networks, maybe some of digital and potentially other engineered replicators. So finding out what is being done, what might happen in the next 5-10 more years, and also the mere theoretical work that suggests what might happen in the next 50-100 years is also extremely useful for populating this specific system. That can lead to scenario planning, where we look at a bunch of these things together and ask how we might, you know, how some of these things might play out in the real world, where systems might be coupled, where food scarcity might affect other problems. So, for example, you might get a change in the climate system. The change in the climate system affects the food system. The food system affects social stability. Social stability affects regional conflict. Regional conflict might lead to nuclear war. So all of these interplaying scenarios are really important to show that, you know, maybe some scenarios that you didn't think originally were GCR scenarios or even existential scenarios could in fact become those things. I think thinking in the systems way helps with that. We need to do a whole lot of aggregation of expertise. Right? We are 8 postdocs, we'll go up to 10 postdocs, even if we were 30 postdocs. There is no way we could be experts on everything I've just mapped out. Even if we achieve it once, right, 5 years later the world has changed and we are no longer experts. So it seems like the way to tackle this is something much more similar to Wikipedia, where you reach out to a much broader community, you suggest that thinking about GCRs and existential risk is an important thing to do, and use expert elicitation to draw out the boundaries of safe operation for some of these systems and what might be effective interventions in those domains. We hold a whole bunch of interdisciplinary workshops precisely because we see the overlap of some of these risks as being points of intervention. So Dirk Durkenberger's work on how to feed everyone no matter what precisely tackles this question of significant reduction in inbound solar radiation. And it's important because we see several risks meeting on that point. Similarly, making our anthropogenic networks more resilient and maybe to some extent more decoupled while keeping them functioning for other purposes is a nice global way of addressing those problems. There's a whole bunch of knowledge sharing, so it doesn't, you know, it doesn't help if we know and we have this dashboard view of what's happening on the planet. This needs to be communicated to policymakers, the people who should make the interventions, to your community, and we hope to get. Third, and finally, there is this issue of academic engineering, which is sensitizing lots of people in various parts of academia to the fact that their work, even though they don't think about it that way, could be relevant to mitigating or preventing existential risk. If you're a plant scientist and you work at some major crop, knowing the safe bounds for operation for that crop, under what temperature would it collapse, might not be something that you would think is important to share with other people, but in fact, it is because we need to aggregate all of those markers. This is going to take, I think, a fair amount of time, but I think we think it's a useful approach to address prevention and mitigation of existential risks in an academic setting. That's all I have. So I think we should take some questions if we have time.
So I'm sure you guys have used Slido at some point today. So if you'd like to go on your phones and yeah, www.slido.com, and it's EAGxOxford. And I'll just give you a minute or two to type in questions and then we can start. Okay, so I think we'll get started and then we can take more questions as they come through. Feel free to upvote questions that you would like to ask. What kind of skills or experiences do you think the X-risk community is currently most in need of?
Numerous. X-risk community is a fairly broad term. So let me first answer what I think CISR needs more. And CISR is positioning itself precisely looking in a systemic way at risks across a whole bunch of areas and doing this kind of academic engineering work. Taking the best out of academia and applying it to existential risk. And that term, like people with very good interdisciplinary background, who have a certain level of systems level understanding, but who are also very good with analytical skills, is the kind of people that we look for. And these people are not easy to come by and could find very good work elsewhere. So, that's part of the question, but there are other answers that are also very useful. But I think we should move on.
So, have you got any advice about how to spread the word on this topic without fear mongering?
That's a good question. Probably because to some extent the fear mongering exists. Right? I mean, there is no shortage of catastrophic movies. In fact, hitting the people, well, when a certain catastrophic movie has come out, discussing that and discussing with people around it, what is tractable within that risk, what is scientifically plausible within that risk, is a very good way of starting the conversation. If you want to go a bit broader, then I think cultivating this notion of custodianship for the pale blue dot is a way of getting at. This is a long-term project, right? This is millions of years worth of work to get this right, and you don't need to, you know, focus on particular risks and others.
Okay, great. So, a topical question. How do you think Donald Trump's election has changed the way that you think about global catastrophic risks?
That's a great question. We've had, in fact, a series of meetings within CISR to discuss this. So, I'll start by saying, you know, we had a chat about Brexit, and the conclusion was not much, except that Britain was maybe pushing above its weight in mitigating climate change, and that's now might be jeopardized. With Donald Trump's election, that's a lot more complicated because the universe yields a whole lot of power, there is a very, very large degree of uncertainty. It doesn't seem like the election of Donald Trump in and of itself is, you know, has put us on a path to GCLs, but it has definitely made some scenarios more likely in the climate change arena, in the geopolitical conflict arena, perhaps with the nuclear war sideline. Or, I mean, you could say that for any big shift of power in any major superpower in our world at the moment. I think it also highlights to us coupling of factors, right? So we don't tend to think about technological unemployment as something that's linked to GCLs. But if technological unemployment through the rise of more populist regimes could lead to destabilization of geopolitics, then maybe that's a pathway in which technological unemployment is something to GCL. So thinking through stressors, which is a much bigger domain to map than just the stuff I showed here, is also something that we're looking at.
So what is the role, if any, of international institutions like the UN in tackling global catastrophic risks?
Extremely important. But you need to think about GCLs more broadly. Right? So the World Health Organization does amazing work at reducing the risk from global pandemics. Could it be done better? Definitely. How would you do it? Either you set up complementary institutions or you join the organization and make it better. Or you do some research about how to make organizations in general be more effective. The same for climate change. You do need to make things fairly tractable and have a fairly convincing research base before you get the UN to do anything. And the UN is never going to be the only solution to some of these problems. So having a much more fine-grained understanding of who is acting in the world in significant ways is important. The UN is one player among many.
So what risks are you most afraid of and find most realistic? Obviously, they don't have to do the same thing.
So if you take one message away from my talk, is that there are many dimensions for this kind of stuff. I take the superintelligent AI risk very seriously, because if we take sort of new theoretical arguments to the conclusion, then AI risks pretty much all of the critical systems on that, because it can have a causal reach into each of these systems. If you think more short-term, there could still be global reach for narrow AI systems that are used in negative ways. I think maybe to a lesser extent, but still quite high.
Okay. And I really like this question. Which question do people not ask you enough?
Which areas of academia should I go and study better, because this will really help me update my model of the world, even if they don't seem to have direct relevance to a decision that I'm about to make.
So why is it important to differentiate between catastrophic and existential risks? Or is it?
It's a hard question. If you have a GCL, but we bounce back, and you value all future lives the same way you value present lives, then the difference is massive. If you have high discount rates, or if you have a good model that tells you that once society has suffered a significant shock, there will be no bounce back, or no significant bounce back, or there is a fairly high probability of no major bounce back, then they collapse into the same. And I think the uncertainty is too high at this point to resolve one way or the other.
Okay, great. And in the interest of time, I think this will be our last question. So systematic exploration of empty boxes in grid may be revealing. How much effort would you put in, or should we put in?
High, but it's hard. So finding unknown unknowns is a very difficult task. But I think this is precisely where going and reading a whole bunch of literature in a field that is often neglected might be a way to go forward. If we have enough people doing this, then I would definitely add it to the list, but I am not sure I can give you a good answer on how to prioritize hitting the red boxes or hitting the green boxes.
Okay, great. Can you join me in thanking Shahar very much for his time and for answering our questions?